Hello learners, I welcome you all in yet another lesson of course code 509 of DLED program of NIOS. Today we are going to talk on a topic from block 3 of unit 6, which is on understanding the nature of learner and the local context. And the today's topic is designing learning experiences using critical pedagogy in social sciences. Now, let me share with you the proposed flow of the lesson before going on the topic. First, we will discuss with you the lesson guide. Then, I will share with you the expectation in terms of learning objectives. Then, I will talk about nature of social science. Then, I will also talk about need to study the social science. Then, we will discuss about facilitating learners' understanding of social science. Then, we will move on critical pedagogy, its concept, background and specification, and after that we will discuss designing learning experiences using critical pedagogy, and after that we will recapitulate and there is a take home task for you. Coming on the lesson guide, during the presentation I will explain and exemplify the different concepts. You should follow my voice and the slides as well. You will find important words and sentences, etc., have been highlighted to facilitate retention. I have also summarized the main points at the end to have a quick glance for better retention. There are some questions or exercises in between also, and at the end of my presentation, you are advised to attempt these questions or exercises after going through this video lesson. Now, let me discuss with you that why the study of social sciences is important, but before going into it, we will discuss the learning objectives or the learning expectations from you. After going through this lesson, you would be able to understand the nature of social science as a live subject. And after going through this lesson, you will also able to get acquainted with the concept of critical pedagogy. You will be also able to design learning experiences in your classroom using critical pedagogy. Now, coming on the nature of social sciences, first we are required to exemplify or to understand that what social science is. Before moving on the critical pedagogy or before discussing that why the study of social science is essential, it is essential to understand that what social science is. Social science is a discipline that deals with the socio-cultural aspect of human behavior. It is the learning and the study which recognizes the simultaneous and mutual action of physical and non-physical stimuli which produces social relation. So, in other words, we can say that social science is a body of knowledge and thought pertaining to human affairs, which means that there is a physical context, and within that physical context there is a social context. Both are interacting with each other, and thereby some human relations, some human affairs are taking birth, and social science is the science to understand or to explain those social affairs or human affairs or the relationship which are emerging because of the interaction between human and human and human and the physical context. Social science can also be viewed as a subject which relates to the origin, organization and development of human society, especially to men in his association with the other men. So, in other words, we can say that it primarily studies the relationship between human and human in a physical context. Now coming that why one should study social science. Just think about your days in school. Whenever we talk about social science, there is a feeling that it's a dull or bored subject or it's a non-relevant subject, but it's not like that. When we talk about social science and its relevance as a subject of study, social science or social phenomena affect people's life profoundly. Everywhere around us, there is something which is happening, and the understanding of that something which is happening around us is very, very important to decide about and to design our behavior and learning to excel in our social atmosphere. Thereby, the learning of social science becomes very, very important. Study of social science facilitates understanding of social phenomena which affects us and hence prepare learner for wholesome social living. Now coming on the diversity as the characteristic of social phenomena. The social phenomena or the things which are happening around us have lots of diversity, and these diversities can be spelled or can be categorized into different categories such as cultural diversities, geographical diversities, linguistic diversities, religious diversities, economic diversities and other diversities which doesn't belong to these five categories. When we talk about cultural diversity, everyone amongst us have a different kind of culture. We speak different language, we eat differently, we dress up differently. When we talk about geographical diversities, the whole of India is divided into different geographical zones. Somewhere there are lots of water, somewhere there are hills, somewhere we are having plains, somewhere we are having growing some different kind of grains. So everywhere the geography is different from one to another place. And as per the geographical differences, our habits, our behavior and our culture differs. Then we are having linguistic diversities. Approximately 1600 languages which have been recognized as an different recognized languages are operating in India. So you can imagine the rich linguistic diversity we have as a country. Similarly, each one of us are belonging to different religion, and also our income or economic status differs from one another. Now coming on facilitating understanding of diverse social phenomena, because we are talking about the study of social sciences as a discipline, thereby we need to understand that how social science facilitate the understanding of this diverse social phenomena. Social science as a discipline, when we talk about its teaching or its learning, we should facilitate, or we can facilitate, the active engagement and constructive involvement of a learner to facilitate understanding of diverse social phenomena. Otherwise, a learner would feel social science as a dull subject. Therefore, the active involvement and the constructive involvement into the activities is very, very important to make social science a meaningful subject or discipline for a learner. Then, for facilitating understanding of the diverse social phenomena, it is required to ensure the social participation of a learner into the different activities. Social participation means different kind of group activities can be organized, or they could have been given opportunities to interact with the community, to interact with the people who are there in their vicinity, to interact within the school community and with their peers. It is also important to facilitate the understanding of diverse social phenomena in the classroom, that the student should be engaged in meaningful activities such as different kind of dramas, dance or aesthetics activities could be taken place in the social science classroom to break its monotonous nature. Now, it is also very important to relate new information to the prior knowledge. We should not discard the knowledge or the information with which our learner is coming. We need to relate that information with the new knowledge we are going to give in the classroom. Now, how to facilitate the understanding of diverse social phenomena? I have deliberated and discussing it in detail, what active and constructive involvement means. Active and constructive involvement means that learning requires the active and constructive involvement of the learner in different kind of activities. And social phenomena, as I have discussed earlier also, social participation is required to facilitate the understanding of the social science, as learning is primarily a social process. Just imagine, can a learner learn individually, or can we learn anything individually? What about the vicarious learning or the social learning? Many of the things which we have learned it through observation or imitation. There was no active learning process for that, which has been conducted by the teacher or any other person in our life. So, primarily and essentially, learning is a social phenomena, and that could happen in a social condition. Therefore, the social participation is very, very important. Therefore, we should think about creating opportunities for social participation of our children in different activities. Now, talking about their engagement in meaningful activities, children learn best when they participate in activities. Adult student, the sitting student, or the student who are just hearing to your lecture won't be able to understand the many things. The things may skip from his cognition, or he or she is not paying attention to the things which you are just talking about. Therefore, different kind of activities are very, very essential to ensure the learner's engagement into the learning process that are perceived to be useful in their life and are culturally relevant. Those kind of activities should be taken into the social science classroom. As I have already told you that relating new information to prior knowledge is very, very important for facilitating understanding of diverse social phenomena amongst our learner. New knowledge is constructed on the basis of what is already understood and believed. Create an analogy for that. Can you construct a house without a foundation? I think no. And thereby, the old knowledge or the knowledge with which the students is coming to the classroom works or functions as a foundation to the house or the building which we are going to construct in the form of new knowledge. Therefore, we should not ignore the knowledge with which the student is coming. We should not treat the student as a tabula rasa who is coming just an empty vessel to the classroom and we need to fill it out. Therefore, it is very, very important to relate the new information or the new knowledge to prior knowledge. And here comes the role of critical pedagogy in the classroom. While elaborating critical pedagogy, it is important to mention the name of great philosopher and educationist Paulo Freire, who wrote Pedagogy of the Oppressed in 1968, and in that book he discussed about the critical pedagogy as a method to teach to student or to teach learner or to make the learning meaningful. He indicated that context interferes into learning. He spoke about his poverty doesn't leave him or spare him while learning. It continuously interferes into the learning experience. It continuously interferes into the type of learning experience which he is gaining or he was gaining in the school. Therefore, we can say that context interferes learning. He also indicated in the book Pedagogy of the Oppressed that accommodation and acknowledgement of the context facilitate learning. Time and again, I was insisting in the first part of the lesson that we cannot ignore the information or the knowledge with which the student is coming to the classroom. That's called the accommodation and acknowledgement of the context, and thereby the accommodation and acknowledgement facilitates the learning. If we are knowing our learner fully, we are going to teach him well, and he is also going to receive whatever is happening in the classroom in a better manner. Pedagogy of the Oppressed, or Paulo Freire in his book Pedagogy of the Oppressed, also insists upon that critical pedagogy means recognition of multiple view of the reality, which can only facilitate the meaningful learning for all and by all. Every one of us, each one of us, and also of our students have different views of reality influenced by the context or from the context they are coming. And therefore, we need to recognize those multiple views that how they are looking at the reality or the thing which we are discussing or happening in the classroom. And on the basis of those multiple views, we can construct the further learning. To include all is also important, those who are systematically excluded to operate on critical pedagogy or to take critical pedagogy as the method in the classroom of social sciences. If we look upon the system which we are having in our classes, we can see that we are systematically excluding some people. For example, if we talk about the medium of instruction in our classes, it is usually English or the prominent language or the dominant language. We don't understand or don't take into consideration that maybe some of our students are not understanding in that language, but ignoring them, we continue to use that particular language, for example, Hindi or anything else. I have a case in one of the senior secondary schools of my area where I was just interacting with some of the students of 8th and 9th class, and what I found was they were not understanding even the Hindi language effectively and properly. But when they have been talked in their native language or their local language, they were understanding all the arguments. So, critical pedagogy requires to identify all those systems and all those practices which are excluding the students or excluding some and would insist upon to include all by giving weightage to the multiple views and multiple experiences. Now, as a teaching approach, critical pedagogy attempting to help student question and challenge domination. For example, no student till the date have asked about that why you are doing a particular thing in your class from a teacher. Have you ever seen that kind of example? I think as a teacher in my class, I haven't. Therefore, we need to prepare our student to question, to become inquisitive and to challenge the domination if we want to operate through critical pedagogy in our class to break the hegemony and to break the domination. And the belief and practices that dominate them as a student or as an individual. So, we need to challenge the domination and we need to grow that caliber into our student also. Critical pedagogy as a teaching approach tries to help student to become critical conscious. Now the question comes, what is being critically conscious? A student is considered to be critically conscious when he or she thinks, reads, writes and speaks while going beneath the surface meaning. Sometimes some things are very, very apparent and we take them on the face of it, but it is not to be done under critical pedagogy. Critical pedagogy requires a deep digging into the issue to understand the whole of the social phenomenon. And therefore, critical pedagogy requires to going beyond the myth, the clutches, the received wisdom and mere opinions. It requires the individual or the learner to become independent in his or her thinking. Critical consciousness also requires students to understand the deep meaning, the root cause, the social context and the personal consequence of any action, event, object, process, organization, experience, text, subject matter, policy, mass media or discourse. For example, in my class, I have debated on with my student on the new money policy or the demonetization policy thoroughly with my student, and I have received a vivid kind of or a different kind of opinions from them on the issue that what are the forces behind the demonetization effort done by the government. So, we need to understand the deep meaning, the root cause in the social context and also its personal consequences of any action, event or anything which is happening around us. We are not bound to take anything on the face of it when we talk about critical pedagogy. It's a co-construction of learning by the student and by the teacher in which they are having an equal position. Now, coming on the characteristics of critical pedagogy, the objective of the pedagogy or the critical pedagogy or the method of education is to empower students, as I have discussed earlier also, and help them to help themselves. Nobody is there to help them. They need to help themselves. The aim of the critical pedagogy is to liberate students from the operation or the operative thoughts. The objective of critical pedagogies also include the including of the excluded, to allow student to gain the necessary social skills to actively participate in the transformed and inclusive democratic community. The critical pedagogy perceives on making the society or the community democratic, that is where everyone has the equal power. Critical pedagogy also aspires to identify the source of power, recognize the own positions in relation to understanding of the own social actions which happen due to the critical pedagogy. Means we are looking at the things, we are just gauging the power center, and we are trying to understand that what we are doing and what is happening actually to us, and then after that we are taking the further action. The objective of critical pedagogy are also includes to accord right and ability to have an input into civic life. Everyone is accorded right and abilities, those who are excluded also, so that they can contribute an input into the civic life. Critical pedagogies challenge the banking concept of education. Paulo Freire, in his book Pedagogy of the Oppressed, indicated that our present education system is operating on the concept of banking system, that is, they are treating, or the teachers or the system is treating the students as an empty vessel which needed to be filled by the teacher. The teacher should know that students have life experiences and their own knowledge that is key in shaping their education and learning, and that knowledge should be recognized. Student not to be blamed for the failure or forced to strip off the knowledge they bring to the classroom, which we generally do in the classes as a teacher. Critical pedagogy needs to challenge, or it is required to challenge, the prevalent culture of silence. In our classes, mostly our students sit with a pin drop silence and they don't talk, they don't ask the questions from us. That culture needs to be broken. He also proposes a method for that, which is called the dialogical method or dialogics, which is a method of critical pedagogy which takes that, or which says that we need to abandon lectures in our classes. We should be open for communication as a teacher with our student, and all teach and all learn in the class where the critical pedagogy or the method of dialogics is getting operated. Equal chance to all should be given, and equal status to all should be given, whether someone is a teacher or someone is a student. That is, all the opinions should be given equal status. A teacher who learns in the classes where the dialogical method has been used, and a learner who teaches. It means there could be a swapping in the position of who is a learner or who is a teacher. A student can become a teacher, and a teacher can become a learner. Dialogic method raises students' consciousness by liberating education. Dialogics method develops critical awareness to make individual to take actions against the oppressive elements, which I have already highlighted in the previous slides. Critical pedagogy and the method of dialogics also stress on praxis. What is praxis? Praxis is reflection and actions, which means that while under action, while going to do something, while doing something, I am, or the person is, reflecting that what is happening or looking at the action. That is called praxis. Through praxis, student acquire a critical awareness of social issues with respect to their own conditions and propose critical resolution. Now coming on critical reflections. Facilitations of observation, relating observation to prior experiences, and contextualization, making meaning out of it and teaching or reaching on conclusion is comes under critical reflection. And this is the cycle on your screen which exemplify the process of critical reflection. As in first step, we have concrete experiences on the feeling basis. At the second step, we are having reflective observation on the watching state. In the third step, we are having abstract conceptualization on the thinking stage. And as the fourth step, we are having active experimentation on the doing stage. And again, we are going on the feeling stage as the concrete experiences, and the cycle moves on. Now coming on the example from the classroom, I have chosen a topic of population explosion to explain how the critical pedagogy could be used as a method in the classroom. So first of all, we are required to ignite the awareness, and while igniting the awareness, we can start from what our student know. We can ask the density of population in their vicinity, number of houses, and an approximation of average number of people living in nearby houses. Then on the second stage, we can facilitate reflection. We can talk about to take few steps further, and we may ask them to the space occupied by each of the family is sufficient or not. Then we can also facilitate the visualization of the magnitude and the effect of the problem. Then we can take them further. The teacher may facilitate student to figure out the reason for the problem and the multiplicity of the student's opinion when clubbed together help proposing the solution. Building further through a case, there is a case on your screen of a tribal student. It is about his whole day's activity, what he does, what he doesn't, and you are required to answer the name and the situation and the events in the story that can be used as basis for teaching learning social science. Of so we can exemplify through a case in which we are exemplifying the daily activities of a tribal child, and we are asking about the different things on the basis of the case, which are: you are required to answer the name and the situation and the events in the story that can be used as the basis for teaching and learning of social science to tribal children. Then you are also required to name the teaching methods or the strategies appropriate for teaching social sciences in the tribal children. Then you are also required to list the concept or the topics that can be used as learning resources or material or examples for teaching social sciences for a child who is coming from an altogether different context. Answer to these are going to help you in understanding the process of critical pedagogy and designing of learning experiences accordingly. To sum up, India is a country incredibly known for its diversity. Despite of distinct identity, communities have organic links with other segment of the population of the region. Under these circumstances, the contents and the pedagogy of social science, particularly at the elementary stage, has posed numerous challenges before the curriculum designer and the teacher. The context of social sciences are formed through child's engagement in activity, experiences, and illustrations. Students are critical observer of their own situation, needs, and context. Teacher should not devise or prescribe solution for them. Teacher should rather make them aware of their abilities and encourage them to think and reason independently. Allow them to express simultaneously. As a teacher, you should keep your mind open to listen to them and respect their views, even though you do not like many of them. This has tremendous pedagogic value, and when used systematically, it is known as critical pedagogy. Now, that's not enough. We will meet again in the second lesson on the assessment of the learners. By then, thank you all. Thank you very much.